All right, enough friendliness for one day. As you're returning to your seats, I do need to make an introduction. We've got a new little one. He's been here before, but we didn't get him introduced. So Brittany and James Lane, why don't you guys stand up with little Elijah there, and we want to introduce them to the church family. And I don't know if we've got a camera. I don't think we do yet. So just hold him up good and tall. Everybody give an awe like you can see him. Hey, Brittany, why don't you come on up here, would you please? And it has their, how old is he now? 4.5 weeks, so just over a month old. Turn around there so they can kind of get a glimpse of him. We're still working on some camera stuff, so. But let's congratulate them on their new little one.
My good morning to all who are here and who are still coming. The ushers are getting ready. They're going to come and circulate a couple things informationally. A couple of things. We're going to have Dan Bohai for one night, the last Wednesday night of the month, coming through. He's traveling, and we agreed to do that. And so that's just to keep that date, save that date. The red one is Christmas in July, and we have linked up with Hope Center, a community organization that outreach. We've been working, a number of us with them, and fusion groups, and all our churches contribute in a lot of ways. But they're going to do something real special Christmas, a community Christmas party. And because of all the things we have going at Christmas time, we felt like we need to do Christmas in July. So we're going to do it ahead of time because we don't want to detract also from Mountain Vision, the other things we do. And thanks so much for your support of Mountain Vision and the Melons. That was a smashing success. Again, thank you for that. So please just take that. We only have about 500 printed off, so if you don't want one, pass it on. But those are, all the details are here for what's needed. And again, if you can't do something, go in with somebody. You know, I'm thinking too, a fusion group, for example. Maybe it's too much for you to do something, but you can all do one thing and pitch in together to do that, okay? Everybody survived the storms all right? Anybody have trees down in your yard significantly? Yeah. Anybody have any damage significantly in the house? You all know that Randy and Cindy, a tree fell on their house. Could have been worse. It wasn't the main trunk, which was very large, and it didn't fall on their neighbors. It fell right between their houses, but it did some damage to theirs, so they're in the midst of trying to get that all covered and repaired. But we're thankful for God's care and protection over us, right, all the time. So at the usher coming again, just send those down the row, and hopefully we have enough to scatter through the crowd. Just pass the extras back, and thank you so very much for how you participate in our outreach efforts. In a while, we'll worship the Lord with his tithes and offerings. When the ushers are coming, you'll know that that's about to happen, and we'll call for them. Another thing I want to mention to you, I just asked Sheldon about his parents, Dennis and Sharon Stauffer. Remember, they're serving in Canada these 6 weeks nearly. And Sheldon said that he's really, really had some rough weather to be taken off and landed in. So let's not forget to pray for Dennis and Sharon, okay? But Dennis particularly, as he is flying workers in and out all over the Canada area in very, very remote areas. And pray for God's favor and blessing. You know, we have these kind of storms and everything here. If they're having them there, that's some serious stuff, isn't it? So please write that on the flyleaf of your bulletin, on your mind and your heart, and remember to pray. All right. We're going to begin with a baby dedication. So if Anthony and Elizabeth Conway are here, we're going to ask them to come forward, please. Where are you? There we are. We're coming. And any family and friends that want to join them, come and stand with them. Mom and Dad, come and face me. Dixie's joining me, my wife, to assist, and Gail, who directs our preschool kids in a very loving way, will be there. Good morning. Good morning. Hello. How are you? She said, where's the candy bucket? Yeah. Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you today?
Hi. Good.
Face me. Yeah. Any other family friends, just come and stand beside them. Feel free to come right ahead. Welcome. Some of you can come right over here too, nice and close. I know it's not everybody's favorite thing to stand up in front of people, but at least you can have your back to them, all right? You don't have to face them. That makes it easier. Come close here, if you will. Good. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. The scriptures say, and we have this concept, but I love it in these verses that I've read, the same verse from different translations. And really, again, this is about mom and dad and family. Because your kids, as brilliant as they are, and every child that I dedicate, that's the smartest, the most brilliant, and it should be that way, but they'll still not remember this day. And that's why it's so important for you all to keep this memory alive. This is a memory, this is a memorial that we make here. So I've been saying lately, the gift really today we're celebrating is God's giving these precious children to us, but it's really God giving them you, mom and dad. That's tremendous. So he says to mom and dad in Proverbs 22:6, train up these children, I'm pluralizing, in the way that they should go, and when they are old, they will not depart from it. The same verse read from the Message paraphrase is, point these children in the right direction, and when they're older, they won't be lost. That's encouraging, isn't it? In 2013, we can receive these words. When I think of children and grandchildren, I know that it evokes feelings, even on the toughest day when we feel overwhelmed. It evokes feelings that are hard to put into words. The indescribable love that you have for these children, I mean, where did it come from? I mean, it just was instant on, right? The bonding that takes place. And so I pray that you'll use this to know that as much as you love your kids, that God loves you more. And the best thing that you can do for them to really love them is to love Him and to love each other. That provides the greatest security. I think I have in my notes for today something about this, that you can only lead, and let's just say, you can only lead your children in the direction you're going. Got it? I find a lot of people that want to send their kids in the right direction. Doesn't work that way so well. I want to say it again. You can only truly lead your kids in the direction that you're going. They're free moral agents. God's given them the gift of free will. They've got to choose that your love and your lives for Him and each other can have a powerful impact on them, falling in love with Jesus for themselves and choosing Him. So this is a Christian dedication. Good, good. Yes, I'm glad you felt free to do that. I'm sorry I didn't think of that sooner. This is a Christian dedication. Christian means not just any God. It means the one true living God. He says, no other gods, only me. It means we are willing to do it His way. That's why it's distinctively Christian. Capital C. And that's my prayer. So before God and these witnesses and these witnesses behind you, will you simply do your very best with God's help, not your own strength, but leaning on Him, as the Bible says, to raise these little ones in the way that they should go? If so, would you answer, we will. And those of you that are loved and are nearby, if you'll use your influence in a positive, God-loving, God-living way, would you answer, we will. And church family, will we do our best to let little children around here know that Jesus loves them? If so, would we answer, we will. All right. Well, we've got two roses for two little ones. Who's oldest here? Elizabeth. Okay. So we use a rose that's not in full bloom, but it has, there's more than a bud there, and it just represents innocence and possibility and purity. And so it's a joy to dedicate little Elizabeth Nicole to God. To the one who made her and created her and who gave her to you, to steward and take care of for yet a little while. So Elizabeth, it's my privilege as pastor here to dedicate you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And the same is true for Anthony Michael, right? He said, I don't know about these flowers. We are so glad for the gift of you, Anthony. And we dedicate you, that's give you back to the one who made you and created you. And we do it in his name, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Father, I thank you for these precious, precious children. And we're so glad for your words when you said, let the children come to me. You love children. What a gift they are. You love them so much that you gave them parents. What a gift. And I pray that mom and dad will see and that these lives will make them contemplate and think even more deeply about loving you and serving you and following you. All through the day, all through the week, all the days of their life, so that their kids, Elizabeth and Anthony, will early fall in love with you and choose to have a love relationship with you. We pray your blessing upon them. Watch over them physically for sure. That sometimes is our greatest prayer. But more than that, watch over them spiritually, emotionally, in every way. And may they be all that you've destined for them to be. And I pray it boldly and expectantly. In the life-giving name of Jesus. Amen. Gail, do you want to add a blessing? Look at that smile.
Anthony and Elizabeth, let's talk to Jesus about you. Father, very often we say the phrase, bless their heart. And today I want to speak a prayer of blessing over the hearts of Anthony and Elizabeth. At the appropriate time, Father, open each of their hearts to receive you and to welcome the light of your love into their lives. May each of their hearts long for a relationship with you, take delight in you, and trust in you. Bless the center of their being with a deep heart identity as God's child, securely loved in your family. Anthony and Elizabeth, be blessed in knowing that the Lord likes you. He enjoys you, and he takes pleasure in who you are and who he created you to be. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. You want to give a little kiss there? Okay. Dixie has some things, some keepsake momentum for you. Let's congratulate this family, this couple. Express our love to them. Derek and Deanna. Before we move into our musical portion of worship today, and we're worshiping when we bring kids to the Lord. You got that, right? We're worshiping when we're fellowshipping and sharing his love. But Shelley Head, that we told you a couple of weeks ago, has released a new CD that some of you have purchased. So Shelley, just come down here. And Nate, I just wanted you to give her a chance to talk to her. Shelley's from a long line of worshipers, I'll call it. And she has such a heart for that, and this project's a culmination, and this house has had a lot to do with it. So just talk to everybody a little bit about it so they can wrap their head and heart around it.
Well, just curious, first of all, who actually purchased this CD 2 weeks ago when it was available?
See some hands.
All right, look around you. If you want to go ask the people if it's worth buying, you go ask them. I won't embarrass them and make them say something about it now.
Talk to Barb.
All right, well, Shelley, the project is called Rivers, and it has been a long, long time in the making. Shelley came to us a few years ago now, talking about the desire that she had on her heart for this project. And so just tell us a little bit about that. What did God do in you that this was born out of?
Well, you would ask me that, you made me cry.
That's good. God, it's a good endorsement.
What did God do in me? Wow. It when you say it was a long time coming, a lot of the songs born in this album are many years old. And I write out of life experience. I write out of what's going on in me. So that's scary sometimes to put that out there. But what God did in me was say, hey, this isn't healthy, what's happening in your heart. This isn't fair, what's happening in your circumstances, but am I still God? And I had to get to that place where I could say, okay, God, I don't understand everything. But the one thing I know that I cannot deny that you are God, you are here, and you gotta fix me. So it was a journey of being made whole. And as I got further and further into that process, and the more I began to write, the more he began to place in me a desire to see others made whole, and began to place within me this dream of not only music that would help people in that journey, but devotionals and teachings to go along with those songs. And I'll never forget, I was sitting in an airport to pick up a friend one night, and her plane was late, and I'm like, okay, Lord, well, let's talk about this project, because I find weird times to talk to God. And he just began pouring it out, and I'm like, I need something to write on, and I'm finding airport flyers and things, and I still have those with the original scribbles of what he began to say, this is how it's going to work. It's a progression. It's a progression. We don't just wake up one morning and say, God, heal me, and it's done. It's a progression, and I think sometimes we do a disservice to the body. God loves us, and he wants every part of us healed.
And the thing I love about that, even what you're talking about, and one of the reasons I love why this is called Rivers, is that, you know, there's always that process of the making of a man or a woman of God to go through that desert season. I mean, even Jesus himself was led into the wilderness by the Spirit. And the fact that coming out of that, something that's so built around that thought of refreshing, is such a great thing. So tell us a little bit about the teachings. How does that work? Are they just random? Are they things that you took from somebody else and wrote in here?
No, they're not random. Let me share this. This one verse I feel like sums up the whole album. The Lord will guide you always. He will satisfy your needs in a sun-scorched land and will strengthen your frame. It will be like a well-watered garden, like a spring whose waters never fail. Isaiah 58:11. And the teachings are specific with each song, and it's a progression of how we go through this journey with God. We can't draw closer to God without consecrating ourselves to him. We can't have our spirits lifted and find joy if we don't learn how to praise him. It's a progression, it's a journey. And so the teachings go right along with that journey to help guide the listener through that process.
And they're not teachings that are actually on there verbally, it's just
correct, they're
written
printed
teachings.
Printed, yeah.
And so finally, why Rivers? I mean, I know I alluded to that a minute ago, but why Rivers? What happened to birth that idea of Rivers?
A couple of things. I mean, the original or the last song on the album is called Rivers, surprisingly. And that is the song that God gave me for healing many years ago. And it's a little chorus that we've done throughout a couple of evening services, et cetera. And it never felt complete to me. And Nate, my youngest son, produced the album, and he helped finish that song and completed the idea of God, you are my source, my strength, and my hope. And wow, I love what we did with the end of that. But also in my job, I work with broken people. And people are 60% water, or they should be. But what happens when people get dehydrated? I'm a personal trainer, an exercise instructor. When people don't hydrate well, they pass out, or they get sick, or they get a headache. Is Eric Keller here? Is he upstairs? Hi, honey. Can I tell on you? Thank you. The first day I worked with Eric, what a journey of health he's on. I mean, what a poster child. But one of the first times we worked together, he passed out, I mean, big time. And he's laying on the floor, and one of my coworkers has his head in her lap, and he woke up and he goes, why is everyone staring at me? Well, you passed out. No, I didn't. Then why are you laying on the floor? He didn't have enough water in his system. But talk about a journey. This is a picture. He came up to me this morning and said, "You're never going to guess. I won the health point decathlon something, some little training thing they did yesterday, a little contest." Eric has been so diligent in his physical, and I know he's a man of God too, we talk, but in his physical journey, what he has done in a year and a half's time is amazing. And that is a picture of our journey. Rivers is about water. It's about healing. It's about coming to a place we've never been.
Do me a favor, just read that initial little bit that's in the very front where you kind of introduce the project. Yeah. Just this little section right here.
It's not fair. I don't have my glasses on.
Well, I can read it for you if you want.
I think you're going to have to.
Okay, I'll read it. We didn't practice that part.
Oh, darn, I'm showing my age.
But this is just a good little overview of what this is. The Rivers Project is all about the pathway to restoration and healing. Just as our bodies need water to survive, so do our souls and spirits long for living water that is offered to us from our loving Father. As the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of the waters, He hovers over us, drawing us to come closer and to know Him more. At a particular painful time in my life, in need of much inner healing, I found myself confused and unable to hear or feel God's presence. It was excruciating. One hot summer day, while out working in my garden, a huge rain came, and God was in the rain. I danced and ran around my yard like a child. I went into the street, and the waters coming down the road began to rise over my ankles, and the Spirit of God began to move inside of me. I stood there in the downpour, arms raised, tears pouring down my face, just laughing and crying and drinking in the joy of His presence. Then my healing journey began. The following are short devotionals that came from this journey. I encourage you to have your Bible with you and carefully read the scriptures listed with each teaching. You may find that the waters of God's presence and healing, no, may you find the water of God's presence and healing through these teachings, scriptures, and offerings of worship. So I would highly encourage you to go out and grab it. We've all been involved in this project, like I said, long
journey. Yeah, I
was going to
say, thank you, guys. I mean, it is so cool how many people from our team were involved, and that was a blessing.
Yeah, and this is a part of it, because long ago we felt like God was going to give a lot of songs to this house, and literally there are songs being sung around the world that have originated here. To God be the glory, great thing He's done. More to come. Don't you agree out there, congregation? More songs to come. And pray that God would raise up. We have a lot of songwriters who are gifted. And we're going to pray that God will continue that. So let's support this. In our worship set this morning, the last song that we do will be a song featuring off of one that she's done. So we're proud of you. We love you. And we'll support you. So let's do it in a tangible way. Okay? I know you will. I know you will. The ushers are going to be prepared now. And as we enter into our worship set musically, we're going to participate in this act of worship by returning and by giving. Returning what belongs to Him, not us, the very first off the top, and by giving for His causes here and around the world. What a privilege to be investment. I can tell you, His investment plan is really good. It's eternal. Pay it forward, okay? So the ushers are coming. As we worship this morning, you be in a posture that best fits you. Our communion corners have been very successful and used in most Sundays. They're pretty well wiped out, and go right ahead, ushers. They'll be uncovered directly, and if one side's out, go to the other. And if we keep running out, we'll start adding more. We don't want to be wasteful, but that's a meaningful part of worship. If you want to come forward, kneel, bow during our worship time, please feel free to do that. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this grand and glorious day, another opportunity to worship you together. We love doing it alone with you, but we love coming together in this way. And so we pray your blessing on this. We've done our best to prepare today musically, prepare a message that you've laid on our hearts, but now may we come together and may we stand as one and worship you, because you're worthy, you deserve it. Regardless of where we are, where we've been, you deserve praise, you deserve glory and honor, and we want to contribute to that today. You are the famous one. We want to make your praise glorious. Thank you for the privilege of being here today, and I pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen. If you want to stand, that's fine. When you want to be seated, that's fine, but feel free to use the front. The corners will be uncovered here directly, and let's make a joyful noise to the Lord.
You are the Lord, the famous one. Thank you. Love that's stronger, love that comes. For you, God, staying humble at your feet, I Forever yours.
Pastor. Can we sing that together? Sing, church, take my life.
Everybody said, amen. Thank you, Shelley, for sharing with us and team. Well done, and really, the songs went so well with what we're talking about today. I shared a few of these thoughts with a few of you, but I feel like there are things I need to share with everybody. This is an old box on which I have many papers that I've written over the years. And I particularly remember this one. Can anybody see what is in the upper right-hand corner? This came from one of the most strict teachers at North Canton Hoover High ever, Mrs. Bergerbile. And she gave us this writing assignment that none of us were really excited about, but we did it anyway. And she handed me this very paper back in front of the whole class and made a big spiel about it. And here I am talking about it over 50 years later. 40. I'm not that old. I'm old. But this goes along with what I want to share with you today. I wrote it, and I called it Freedom Under the Law. And you can tell, I mean, this is original, you know, yellow paper. You remember back when we used to write things by hand? Anybody remember those days? When you used to know how to sign your name and spell your name before computers? At first, one would think the phrase freedom under the law is contradictory because laws are rules to live by and freedom is having no restrictions. However, this phrase refers to the freedoms or liberties we have or do not have within the boundaries of the law. Taking all this into consideration, do we, as an American nation, have freedom under the law? Question. We do have freedom under the law, and we must have laws to guarantee our freedom. Here on earth, no one can be totally free of laws or rules. All men have restrictions they must comply with, no matter what occupation they hold. Even gangs make up rules and regulations to live by. If there were no laws, someone would always be stepping on someone else's toes, thus taking away the other individual's freedoms. Some of the laws we have limit our activities to some extent, but at the same time, they guarantee our own personal freedoms. The laws we have act as a protective shield, protecting us from people and things in the world around us. Freedom implies obligations both to oneself and to others. All of these factors seem to indicate that we do have freedom under the law and that we must have laws to guarantee our freedom. It is most important to remember that to have freedom under the law, we must fulfill obligations we have both to ourselves and to others. In other words, to get the most out of our freedom, we must be considerate of others. That's pretty good stuff, isn't it? For a high schooler that didn't know much. But that's so small and insignificant compared to freedom as received from our Heavenly Father through Jesus Christ. It seems to me that we're a part of a culture that is so obsessed with individual rights, freedoms, and choices as we see it and understand it. And that's where the rump comes in many times. But we seem to have forgotten how much of it is due to the restraint, the good things we enjoy is due to the things that we would call duties or rules. And I've determined that we all need boundaries to keep us moving forward, right? That's why some of you aren't going anywhere because you don't have any boundaries. I remember a long time ago, when our kids were very small, that we occasionally, at least a couple of times, took them for a bowling experience when they were real little. You know, they could hardly lift the ball. The bowling ball was so heavy. And what was the things that they put always in the gutters? Gutter pads or bumper pads, right? These things that they filled up so that no matter where the kids threw the ball, it would bounce from side to side, but at least it'd get where it's going instead of going in the gutter, because if it always went in the gutter, they would grow weary, lose interest, lose heart. In short order. So I said again that we need boundaries of love to keep us moving forward. I remember before I ever wrote this paper being in a junior high school health class where one of our teachers, maybe it was Don Hertler, Coach Hertler, teaching us about peristalsis. That was something that happened when we swallow, where our intestine or our esophagus and all that, it kind of goes like this and it helps the food get to where it needs to be. God's word shows us clearly that we have to have boundaries that help us to get to where we want to be, where we want to go. And I'll illustrate that today. So placing ourselves under the authority, yes, the authority of God is absolutely necessary. It's God ordained. It's a part of life, even though it's not taught much today. It seems that we're being oversold on the extremes of independence and dependence, but the extremes, how many of you know, always end us up in the ditch. It seems to me that Stephen Covey had it right when he talked about that interdependence. Some of you know that we celebrate military around here and who they represent, and many of you have served faithfully through the years. And you know this, and you learned this there, that in the military, you learn this basic truth. The only way you can learn to give orders is to first learn to accept orders. Agreed? In other words, we need to be willing to take orders before we're ready to give them to others. It's a necessary, humbling process along the way. Authority is learned by being under authority. Our fulfillment, our significance, our purpose, and many times I believe leads directly to the vast and often barren land of obedience. My pastor friend used to say, it could have been Eugene Peterson wrote, he said, it's a long obedience in the same direction. And we'll illustrate that from God's word. I said in the baby dedication, and I say it again to all of us in a different context probably, but it occurs to me that in this business of being under authority, whatever God calls us to do and however he calls us to lead, we can only lead in the direction that we're headed. We can't send people in the right direction. We have to take them in the right direction. We can only lead in the direction we are going. How many of you know that's true? That's a problem in our culture for sure. Well, I want to talk about this and go to the Old Testament. And really, I could have done this message before I did the one last week. I talked about Moses and some of the things that he encountered. And we talked about standing. Remember that? About standing. But I came across some time ago, I love to read various Jewish rabbis who write things about the Old Testament. And I have a number of sources for that. And I ran across the one who wrote some insights about the Passover, and I thought it was so phenomenal. Even today, I was having insight as communion was going on, and I want to talk about that, and I want to give you a little bit of the backstory in these moments we have remaining. You know the story, and I encourage you to go back and read it again, but 70 descendants of Jacob took refuge with Joseph in Egypt during the famine. And due directly to God's gracious favor, in the midst of great oppression and bondage, they became an extremely powerful nation. Do you remember the story? In the very worst of circumstances, God did something great among them, and they filled the land. Exodus 1, 6, and 7. Let me read it. In time, Joseph and all of his brothers died, ending an entire generation. But their descendants, the Israelites, had many children and grandchildren. In fact, they multiplied so greatly that they became extremely powerful, and they filled the land. In the midst of horrible times and oppression, God was preparing them for something more than what was. Now, I'm not just telling you a wonderful story so we can go, my, isn't a wonderful story. We're going to the biblical context to see how God is working and active right now in our lives, right where we are. So we remember that God brought them out of Egypt, not so that they would merely survive. He didn't send them to Egypt just so they would survive. No, in the picture, that was much bigger. He wanted them to thrive, and thrive they did in the most unlikely circumstances. This was accomplished in the midst of many years of hardship. And you know what they were? What was happening during that time? They were actually being prepared for God's purposes. How many of you know that was good for them, but that's not good for us? No, it's the same principle. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. You know the song? Exodus 1:12. But the more the Egyptians oppressed them, the more the Israelites multiplied and spread, and the more alarmed the Egyptians became, because they couldn't do anything to stop what God was doing. Right? They couldn't stop it. Verse 13. So the Egyptians worked the people of Israel without mercy. Some of you feel like you're right there. 14, they made their lives bitter, forcing them to mix mortar and to make bricks and do all the work in the fields. They were ruthless in all their demands. I mean, that's serious. They were treated ruthlessly. The oppression was real. I mean, it was horrible. It was painful. Conditions weren't good. They somehow began to believe that the God who had called them had abandoned them along the way. He had forgotten about them. They were devastated by despair that we talked about last week. I mean, their hope was at an all-time low. It didn't even show up on their dipstick. No hope. All-time low. But even during this season, they kept getting stronger, and they were multiplied. They may not have seen it, but God was still working. And here's God's response in Exodus 3:7. The Lord talking to his servant Moses that he called, I have certainly seen the oppression of my people in Egypt. I hope you're getting this. This is way more than just for them. It's for you and for me. I have heard their cries of distress because of their harsh slave drivers. Yes, I am aware of their suffering. Isn't it encouraging to know that God is aware of where we're at? Well, if he does, why doesn't he do something about it? Verse 8. So I have come down to rescue them from the power of the Egyptians and to lead them out of Egypt into their own fertile and spacious land. This is a land flowing with milk and honey, where the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites now live. In other words, it's occupied, but I'm taking you there. But the Lord had not forgotten him, the scripture said, and he had not forgotten his promises to them. Time has nothing to do with the fulfillment of God's promises, you know, I mean, because he operates outside of time. And yes, I know, and you know, and read for scripture how many years the children of Israel were growing there and being prepared there. I mean, it was over 400 years, you know it. He described how he would deliver them from bondage from so many years. Jump ahead to Exodus 12. Here are your instructions for eating this meal. This was the first Passover, and we want to do a couple takeaways from this that are so practical. Be fully dressed, wear your sandals, carry your walking stick in your hand, eat the meal with urgency, for this is God's Passover, the Lord's Passover. Verse 12, on that night I will pass. He's telling you what he's going to do ahead of time. Don't you wish God would always do it this way for us? On that night I will pass over the land of Egypt and strike down every firstborn son and firstborn male animal in the land of Egypt. I will execute judgment against all the gods of Egypt, for I am the Lord. Wow. 13, but the blood on your doorpost, the blood on your doorpost will serve as a sign making the house and marking the houses where you are staying. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. How many of you remember in church when we sang songs about the blood? This plague, I better read that again. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. This plague of death will not touch you when I strike the land of Egypt. This is a day to remember. Each year from generation to generation, you must celebrate it as a special festival. To the Lord, this is a law for all time. Wow. The children of Israel cried out to the Lord for help and deliverance, but there's no way they could have ever imagined how the Lord God was going to do it. Have you ever been there? Some of you are there right now. It's too big. I mean, put yourself in their shoes. As big as they were, they're overwhelmed by the greatest nation on the earth at the time. But God wanted them always to remember his mighty acts on their behalf so that they would never forget. I'm afraid that that's one of our greatest spiritual limitations, that we tend to forget what God has done. We forget his faithfulness throughout the generations. Let me read on. 24 of 12. Remember, these instructions are a permanent law that you and your descendants must observe forever. When you enter the land the Lord has promised to give you, you will continue to observe this ceremony. I love this one. Then your children will ask, what does this ceremony mean? And you will reply, it is the Passover sacrifice to the Lord, for he passed over the houses of the Israelites in Egypt, and though he struck the Egyptians, he spared our families. When Moses had finished speaking, all the people bowed down to the ground and worshiped. And that was just a natural response. All right. Through his servant Moses, I'm honing in here, God told them ahead of time exactly how he was going to accomplish their deliverance. And he did it exactly how he said he'd do it, because I want to tell you, God always keeps his promises. And it doesn't matter what time it is. And so the Exodus came about. And I just want you to think for a moment, what is the Exodus about? When I was a kid, we sang majestic songs and played songs about the Exodus. This land is mine. God gave this land to me. What's it about? I want to come to that. In chapter 12, verse 31, Pharaoh sent for Moses and Aaron during the night and said, get out, he ordered. Leave my people and take the rest of Israelites with you. Go and worship the Lord as you requested. Well, I'm going to suggest to you right here and now that the Exodus was about worship. Freedom to worship. Freedom to worship God according to the dictates of their heart. Verse 32, take your flocks and herds, as you said, be gone. But by the way, bless me as you leave. I find that rather humorous. All the Egyptians urged the people of Israel to get out of the land as quickly as possible, for they thought we will all die. Finally, Pharaoh and his people have seen enough of God's hand and miracles. I think the people of Egypt have seen it long before and were ready for their departure long before Pharaoh was. They literally pushed the people of Israel out. And literally, Israel left with their blessing. Verse 36, same chapter. The Lord caused the Egyptians to look favorably on the Israelites. This is so neat. And they gave the Israelites whatever they asked for, and they asked for a lot. So they stripped the Egyptians of their wealth. They didn't steal it. I mean, they gave it to them and said, go. Isn't that incredible? That night, the people of Israel left Ramses, and they started for Succoth. There were about 600,000 men, plus all the women and children. Verse 38, a rabble we talked about in one another message of non-Israelites went with them along with great flocks, herds, and livestock. And that came back to bite them later. Remember that? The rabble that incited rebellion against God. But once again, even in this passage, I'm saying that it happened exactly as God had told Moses. They plundered the nation of Egypt when they left and left with great favor. They were driven out in a hurry in the middle of the night with urging and favor and blessing of their captors. Verse 40 says that the people of Israel had lived in Egypt for 430 years. That's a long time to be in bondage, isn't it? In fact, it was on the last day of the 430th year that the Lord's forces left. I like that. The Lord's forces left the land. On this night, specifically, as God said, the Lord kept his promise to bring the people out of the land of Egypt. So this night belongs to him, and it must be commemorated every year by all the Israelites from generation to generation. And how do you know they're still doing it? They think that God meant what he said. So let's take a couple of lessons and applications away from this. According to this particular rabbi, he said that so many times he encounters people that mistakenly believe that the Passover is only a liberation celebration. That's good, isn't it? I mean, liberation and freedom is a good, good thing. He said it is that, but it's not just that. If we'll take note, we'll remember that Moses didn't come to Pharaoh and say, just let my people go. God said, let my people go. He said, no. He said, I demand that you let my people go because we're going to go worship you according to the dictates of our heart. We're going to go worship you in the wilderness. That was the desire of their hearts. For example, Exodus 7:16, say to him, Jehovah, the God of Hebrews, has sent me back to demand that you let his people go. Not my people, but his people go to worship him in the wilderness. Oh, that's a good line. I demand on the authority of Lord God who has commanded that you let his people go to worship you in the wilderness. And so you can check it out in your Bible that every confrontation with Pharaoh that Moses had, he demanded that he let the people of God go to worship in the wilderness. I won't take time to go into it, but I have Exodus 10:24, and I think in another maybe devotional I gave on a Wednesday night some time ago, I love that line that after the last plague, before Pharaoh hardened his heart for the last time, before the Passover occurred, he finally told them, he said, you can go, but leave your flocks behind. And I love the response. Moses said, no, all of the livestock must go with us too, because not a hoof can be left behind. And we talked about that. And he said, here's why. Because we won't know how to worship we are to worship the Lord until we get there. That's a powerful statement. Because worship demands that we be all there. Nothing left behind. Completely in the moment. Here's the point. Here's the point I don't want you to miss when it comes to this freedom and this authority thing. I want to tell you on the authority of God's word that we're never out from under his authority. God simply was intent on moving the people of Israel out from the abuse and the authority of the Egyptians. He didn't want them to be servants there any longer. He wanted them to be servants of the one true living God because he's a jealous God. And so he's calling us out of our bondage to a place of freedom. He said, enough of the lesser gods, the small gods. I am the only God. Worship only me. You serve me only. You'll never be out from under his authority. I want you to come to a place of worship under my authority where you can know freedom like you've never known it, because true worship is about being there in my presence with nothing left behind, nothing to go back to, all the bridges burnt behind. And I jotted down, and I probably would subtitle the message this: there just seems to be something special about worship that happens in the wilderness. I said, there just seems to be something real powerful and special about worship that happens in the wilderness. Wilderness worship, if you will, is a powerful thing. Standing, learning to stand in the wilderness is a powerful expression of worship to God and to others who see you standing in awe and amazement of God in the middle of a wilderness, regardless of how hot and how dry and how long it's been. Being enslaved by man is not a good thing, but being a servant of the living God, enslaved, a love slave of his, that's a place of greatest freedom that you could ever know and imagine. But it talks about the need for what Shelley's song talked about, the need for absolute consecration and surrender. And so the celebration, the Passover celebration, accepts the fact that God rules over the affairs of man, that we need to accept God's rules. It recognizes his authority. It does not reject it in any way. Oh, we live in a world where people mistakenly long for an existence without external or eternal rules or restraints. And we might think that humans would thrive in that atmosphere, but we're firsthand witnesses these days that show that we tend to self-destructive left to our own devices. Agreed? It's what's happening in our world. We're like small children that tend to go around and say, "You're not the boss of me." Well, somebody is. Hear me, please. The people of Israel were long enslaved 430 years to the very day in Egypt by Pharaoh and the people. That was not an accident. It served a vital function for them. In essence, it taught them how to take orders so that they could submit to an almighty God in the wilderness, because it was in the wilderness, look at me, that they learned how to worship. They didn't know how to worship before. I said it was in the wilderness that they learned. I mean, they may have met God, Jehovah, some years ago, but they didn't get to know him until they were in the wilderness. You remember Dave Ramsey that taught Financial Peace University that so many of us participated in? He said basically his testimony is this: he met God on the way up. Woo, everything is great, and he got to know him on the way down. That's a pretty powerful testimony. Some of you can agree with that. So could I say this to you? The Passover that God said, never forget, so you will always remember, so that you'll never forget, he said, it really, in essence, it celebrates or it remembers your captivity. Don't ever forget where I brought you from. Some of you today are struggling with that very thought because you forget. You forgot how God touched you, how he came to where you were, and how he brought you a long way out. Don't ever forget where he found you and what he has done. Don't ever forget where you are compared to where you were. Be reminded. Great is your faithfulness. They thrived in this oppressive environment. They became, listen, mentally, emotionally, and physically fit for the journey they were about to embark on. But I'll tell you, it was in the wilderness that they became spiritually fit. Where? In that dark place. So every year, count on it, the people of Israel commemorate both slavery and liberation. Slavery and freedom. And they're saying to us today, God still rules over the affairs of men. We will never forget. And if they were here, they would say, you know, maybe Joseph's words are so wise and prophetic right here. Man may have meant it all for harm, but God meant it all for good. Powerful. Powerful truth. I'm nearly done. Here's the truth of the Passover story. True independence doesn't come from abolition of rules. Freedom comes truly when we recognize, respect, and accept divine rule. Freedom comes only when we're willing to recognize and submit to God's authority. It's when we stand, yes, in the wilderness under the authority of Almighty God and recognize Him. I was thinking about that again this morning, and I came to this thought. I was thinking about the Passover, and I was thinking about communion. And I find it interesting that in both things that we remember, Jesus said to do this, remember, blood was involved. And in both cases, it's blood that leads to freedom. And Jesus said, remember my death. And do this, and as often as you do this in remembrance of me. Do it so you'll never forget where I found you. Do this so you'll never forget that you learned to worship in the wilderness when you were oppressed and beaten down. You'll never forget the ditch God found you in. That's the story. Learning to stand under the authority of God. That's the line, one nation under God that recognizes and respects and accepts His authority. Moses did not urge Pharaoh to let his people go free. He commanded them to him to let them go so that they could worship the one true living God in the wilderness. No other gods, only me. Moses recognized early on that they were always to be under God's authority. That's where freedom was. And looking back from where we now stand, we know that some of their very best times, the most memorable times, greatest times happened in the wilderness, because I want to say it again, and you check it out biblically. It was in the wilderness that they really learned what worshiping God was about. I think that's where they got the Ten Commandments, wasn't it? Where was that? In the wilderness. That's where they received the ordinance of God. Wilderness worship. And I'm here to submit to you today, based upon this, that we have to remember in order to celebrate. Right? We just came through the July 4th. What were we celebrating? The independence of this nation. Agreed? I said we have to remember in order to have something to celebrate. We remember God, His deliverance, His mercy, His grace. They remembered the bondage and they celebrated the freedom. And that's really what we do when we come to the table of the Lord. We're remembering the bondage that we were in to sin, but that He provided through the blood of Jesus Christ freedom and deliverance so that we could stand and worship Him. Are you with me? I'm afraid that practically speaking, some of us are more into celebrating freedom, and if we don't have freedom as we think we should, we're all up in the air about it. But He's saying, don't forget to remember the captivity, the bondage, the place I brought you from. Isn't that what a testimony is? Frank, I was there, and He met me there, but He didn't leave me there. He brought me here to where I stand. Are you with me? Let me see some head nods. Have you forgotten? It doesn't matter what your story is. That's the story, the compelling story we have to share our faith with others. This is what God did for me. I was a slave. I was in bondage. But He's given me freedom through the blood of His precious Son, Jesus Christ. I will never forget. And so I will intentionally remember. Well, I'm glad the children of Israel learned how to worship in the wilderness. That doesn't work for us. Oh, yes, it does. Because that's where the standing really works. And you go back and check out the Old Testament again. You'll find many times when they had convocations of worship that it involved people coming and standing with their kids for hours in the presence of God, standing together. And so I feel like God's saying to our hearts today, you may be in a wilderness. It may not be 430 years because most of you haven't lived that long, I don't think. But I have not forgotten you. I have not abandoned you. And what I want to do in this midst of this very crushing circumstance, things you don't understand, I want to teach you how to stand. I want to teach you wilderness worship that is not based upon anything else but my presence. I will stand. I will worship. I want to recommend highly being a servant of the Most High God. I think Jesus came to give us a glowing example and said, basically, you need to do what I'm doing. And he took up the towel and he served others. And I'm asking for us for application, that God in his love would impress upon our hearts the truth to not look beyond the circumstances we're in, but know that God is preparing us. It's no accident. God has not been absent. He's going to use. He is using. He is working even now. He's making you stronger. He's strengthening you. He's showing you things you would not have ordinarily learned. He's working even now, but you're going to even see greater things that God uses for the very wilderness that you've been willing to stand. And all the people said. And maybe that's going to be a part of heaven when we get there, because we have limited reality. But when we see him face to face, we're going to know as we are known, and we're going to be blown away how he was working all along. So I think it's time for us to dedicate our wilderness experience to him and say, God, I want to be this a waste of time. This is some really hard, painful stuff. So I might as well really learn to know who you are and really learn to stand and to worship you in this time. So I'm going to invite you to stand, if you would, now. And as we pray and conclude, if there's a wilderness time, a season that you need to surrender to the Lord, if you've never met him personally today and you're floundering on your own, I tell you with conviction that he hasn't forgotten you, he hasn't forsaken you. He's working, he's drawing you. There's not a thing that has happened, is happening, will happen that he cannot use for his glory to be lifted up so that he can draw others. If there's something you're struggling with today and you want to spend the close your praying, if you want to come and meet him and surrender your life, your sin to him, if you want to pass through the blood of Jesus and be made clean, you can do that today. Father, thank you for your powerful word of truth and for this ceremony. Not just the Old Testament one that signified you passed over and your miraculous power and your hovering presence over them, but even now, and Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. May we be in awe over the freedom you've extended to us, and that is for all of us in this room today. May you change our attitude and our outlook about the wilderness, and may we begin to see how we've been growing stronger and how you've been faithful. And even though things haven't worked out the way we thought they should, you're working even now, and we have great expectations for the future. May your presence and blessing draw the heart of this precious congregation, individual by individual, family by family, to you, deeper into the heart of God. And we submit ourselves, Lord, to your authority and find freedom within your loving boundaries to be all that you want us to be and more than we could ever be on our own. Have a purpose for living, a significance for living, a joy. We want to know that. And we thank you for your provision. We're going to just sing a little as we dismiss. And if you're here, if there's still some communion elements there, you can partake of those. If you want to come and bow and just talk to the Lord and ask him to give you a new perspective, to be the lifter of your head and heart right where you are, to consecrate this wilderness, not to be a wasteland, to be purposeful and instructive in your life, whatever the season may be. Thank you, Father. When you need to go, you may do so, but we're going to make this a place of prayer. You're always free to come and go as you need to, but this is a place of prayer. I want to be a wilderness worshiper. Today, right now.
Like the desert needs.
I want to stand. I want to have the courage to stand when I don't understand, when I don't see it. I want to stand.
I need
I
your
will stand and worship you.
Like the fire needs the flame. One moment with the
and my confidence in you today, Lord. I thought I was alone for a while, but I know I'm not.
A lifetime with you.
I'm consecrating myself to you. I want to get to know you better in this world.
Heaven alone.
I want to learn how to worship you, to draw near, to say that you're enough. You're the only. More than enough.